Hi, it's yet another exciting episode of Development Issues on Omenira TV. I welcome you. My name is Zainab Sani. Nigeria's inflation hit 18.17% in March 2021. The last time the country's inflation was this high was in 2017 when it hit 18.17%. While we understand that this has huge implications for the cost of living and food prices, the big question remains, what is the implication of this for development of the country, particularly as it concerns the sustainable development goals? Joining me to have this conversation is Dr. Sam Babalola. Dr. Sam Babalola is a doctor of curriculum and instructional design and education for sustainable development from the Department of Arts and Social Sciences, University of Ibadan. It's quite a pleasure to have you on Development Issues this month, Dr. Babalola.
Thank you. It's my pleasure to be with you.
All right. So I know that your research area focuses on designing the right educational materials for sustainable development growth.
Yeah.
You know, considering the experience you have and all of the research you have done, how well will you say Nigeria is doing when it comes to the sustainable development goals?
This is a very huge question. Without missing word about it, Nigeria is not doing so much, especially when you compare, her with what other countries, even just like Rwanda, other African countries like Rwanda, South Africa, even countries like Egypt, what they are bringing to the table. Even Kenya, when you consider what they are doing, you know quite well that Nigeria is not doing as much as she should be doing in driving, sustainable development, especially in the aspect of education also. Education is key, the concept of education is that people first and foremost need to be educated. They need to know. They need to be informed.
Need to understand.
They need to understand before they can make the right choices, as it has to do with sustainability. But just like the MDGs suffered,
The SDGs also suffered the same fate.
The SDGs also suffered.
And this is despite huge grants allocation from international bodies and agencies.
Yes, United Nations, World Bank, and some of these UNESCO even, some of these agencies, multinational agencies, and are giving money, giving grants, for some of these initiatives so that they can spread it out to the common man on the street. I carried out a study in 2017, for example, and the reason for that study is that we all know that graduates are the key drivers of any economy.
Mm.
And so I wanted to find out to what extent are they aware, of the Sustainable Development Goals. Let's not forget, the Sustainable Development Goals implementation started in September 2015. So by 2017, I was on the field. I wanted to find out to what extent, do undergraduates, to what extent are they aware of those goals. It was shocking when we found out that many of our undergraduate students across, selected universities in Southwest Nigeria do not even know. Just tell us what you understand. Some of them could not explain. Something as basic as how many goals are the sustainable development goals.
Mm.
None of them could articulate, and on and on like that. So there is a gap, there's a knowledge gap.
Alright. Now, moving away from that, when Nigerians hear the word inflation, what comes to mind is a rise in food prices, shrinking wages or salaries, and very high cost of living, But how does this tie to development as it relates to sustainable development?
Well, those issues, you see, the beautiful thing about sustainable development is that it is a cycle. That's why we have three pillars. We call it three pillars of sustainable development. We have the pillar of economy, we have the pillar of environment, and we have the social cultural interactions. So when you look at food, for example, to an average person on the street, those are very, very vital, you know, needs that has to be met, you know. So food, household prices or household commodities, you know, they are very key to sustainable development, because part of the goal is that people should be able to have decent lifestyle, have decent work, have decent job, and also be able, you know, to guide against hunger. You know, more than 1 billion people are still suffering living in extreme poverty. So extreme poverty is that you are unable to eat 3 square meals.
Mm.
Sure, you understand. So issues like that are linked. You know, they are linked. You know, they are crucial when we are looking at the concept of sustainable development holistically. So I think it is vital. You know, when people see inflation, you see, and again, we have an average Nigerian, they are in the majority,
mm.
you know, and not just in Nigeria, in the entire world. And so the issues that concerns them are not the very lofty issues of life. You know, what concerns them is food, shelter, and clothing.
Sure then.
You understand? Okay. Then when you take that away, then they can begin to talk about education, going to school, sending their children to school, and things like that. But you see, when those things are not intact,
then there's a big problem.
There is a very, very big problem.
I like that you raised the subject of decent work and also of poverty,
yeah.
because goal 8, there are 13 goals, like you said, but yes. goal 8 focuses on decent work and social economic growth.
Yeah.
Then when you consider that 2.2 billion people in the world live on less than $2 a day,
mm-hmm.
that's about 700 naira or less.
Yeah.
Then coming down to Nigeria, Nigeria is the poverty capital of the world. In Nigeria, we have such alarming rates of unemployment.
Yeah.
And when you put all of this together, what can we expect to see in the next couple of months?
Well, I do not like, you know, being negative. But you see, the statistics and the handwriting on the wall is not really, really in the positive. Just recently, there was all this back and forth, you know, in the Ministry of Finance about having to print so much money, about 60 billion naira,
mm-hmm.
you know. When you hear things like that, you know quite well that the economy is not really doing well. In a situation where the economy is doing well, you know, the CBN will not resort, you know, to printing more money, because we know quite well that printing more money is injurious to any economy that wants to really develop. So I want to say that the whole thing is not looking too well, you know, the whole thing is not looking too bright for us as a people, because unemployment is at an all-time high. The same with inflation. You quoted inflation in March was, I can tell you that as we speak, it's eating almost 20%. Even inflation is eating 20%. So it's not. I don't know what to say again. It's not right, you know. It's not decent. It's not sustainable. I think that's just the word. It's not sustainable.
Sustainable.
You know, because we are talking about sustainability. It is not sustainable when your inflation rate is, you know, climbing to 20%. You know, you have an all-time high unemployment rate, you know, and your foreign exchange is at an all-time high. So when you look at all of these things, when you put them all together, it's not looking bright. The future is not looking bright. And I think it's time we just all rise up to it.
Okay. Now, talking about solutions, what's the place of economic liberty in all of this? Is there a way Nigeria can deploy economic liberty to finding its way out of this rat hole called inflation?
By economic liberty, I wouldn't know what you
mean. I'm referring particularly to encouraging capitalism,
okay.
you know, relinquishing government control of some key agencies.
Okay.
For example, the NNPC, as at yesterday, I read a story where they spent more than 5 billion naira in December 2020 alone on 3 refineries with 0 outputs.
Mm-hmm.
So is there a role capitalism has to play here? Should government relinquish some of its control on key agencies to drive business, to drive growth? You know, would that work, you know, in solving the inflation problem that we have?
That has been the people have been clamoring for that. That has been people, you know, demand. When you look at economy, they are doing very well. You will see that you have less of government intervention in key sectors of such an economy. For example, Nigeria is putting its nose or our nose, you know, in almost everything. In electricity, they are the one regulating, you know, in fixing of a pump price of petroleum, PMS, diesel, and kerosene.
Regulating.
It's still the federal government that is regulating. You know, when it comes to managing, you know, customs related activities, shipping, export, and all, you see government actively, you know, regulating all of these things. And people have been saying that for an economy, you know, to fare well, you need less, you know, of government intervention. So I want to say quite well that an economy that will do well, you know, must allow private initiative, you know, to actually come, you know, into their sector, into their economic sector, to drive growth in every economy that today can be called developed. You understand? The private sector, they are the ones driving. When you look at it, for example, even presently in Nigeria, the companies that are doing very well, they are privately owned, they are privately driven. You talk of Dangote is private, you talk of MTN, these are private companies, and they are multinational, you know, telecommunication companies that are doing very well across Africa. You understand? Why? Because the principle of business is not the same with the principle of governance. There is an hub called Co-Creation Hub in Lagos. You know, this was a hub, you know, that started as a result of a private, you know, private initiative. You've seen it was through the influence of such a hub that, you know, the likes of the founder of Facebook and what was it called, Jack?
Twitter.
Came. It was on that platform that he came to Nigeria. You understand? So there is no limit to which the private sector can take us. And by that, I mean they can take us very far if the government will create an enabling environment, you know, for them to try. Also, don't forget Paystack. Is it Paystack?
Okay, we can go on and on mentioning brands' name and examples. But what is the place of education in all of this conversation that we are having? What role does education have to play? And how can education be actively deployed in solving these problems?
Education is key to solving any problem at all. You know, we call it, it is a tool of social reconstruction. It's also a tool of preservation and also a tool of creativity. And when people are educated, you know, they do well. They understand government initiatives. Someone who has not been to school, who is not literate, how do you want to communicate government intervention, government projections, you know, government initiatives? They won't understand.
But even for those that are going to school at the moment,
yeah,
are the curriculums, you know, suitably designed to capture what the sustainable development goals mean and its impact for society?
That's another, you know, that would be another level. Understand? By education, I mean, you know, basic literacy. Basic literacy, basic arithmetic. Because this is the foundation. When this foundation is properly laid, you know, to talk to them about sustainable development will not be difficult. Because they already have, you know, a background that will help them to understand. Now, but in Nigeria, we are also almost the capital of out-of-school children. When you look at the number of out-of-school children in Nigeria, it is the rate.
Figures are as high as 13 million.
You understand, as 13 million, the rate is alarming. So, and those are prone to, you know, they are time bombs. You know, because these are willing hands that can easily be manipulated, that can be used for election violence and be used for criminal activities and even terrorist-related, you know, activities. So I am saying that for you to drive development at all, you need first and foremost to get your citizens educated. Now, when they are educated, you know, on the basic of literacy and arithmetic and all of those basic things we do at the primary school level, then you can now begin to engage them on further issues like sustainable development. It is when you do that, they will understand what you're actually talking about. Many people don't even, if you don't have basic literacy, how do you understand something?
And it brings me back to your point earlier, yeah. Of even if when we cannot even eat, how do we even, you know, get basic literacy? Okay, now as we round up this conversation, Dr. Babalola, you are a member of a committee trying to find solutions to Nigeria's current inflation rate, and as an expert in sustainable development, what would be your advice to that government think tank that is working to end inflation in Nigeria, or working to reduce inflation in Nigeria?
Well, the first thing would be to be realistic. Let's know quite well that things are not going the direction they should be going. You see, once you realize the foundation of your problem, I am of the opinion that your problem, you know, is half solved. That's number one. Number two is that we need more of technocrats. We need more of, you know, we need less of politicians in our economic sector, in our financial sector. You understand? So let's bring in hands, you know. Unfortunately, the issues that Nigeria is confronting Nigeria, they've always been there. But you see, the reason why they did that, those issues did not really come at us the way they are coming at us now, is because we had experts that were trying to stem issues, that were trying to manage issues, you know. We have the likes
of the infusion of people like Dr. Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala helped.
You know, people like that, the former CBN governor,
Soludo,
Sanusi, you know, and their likes. You know, we had very brilliant hands that were managing our economy. But today, you know, the situation is different. So I would say bring in hands, competent hands that have been proven, you understand, that can bring in, that can inject fresh ideas into the way, you know, things are being done. And I also would say that first and foremost, also address the issue of power. The issue of power is key, you know, to developing any economy. So create an enabling environment, let there be security, you know. We have a lot of issues. Nobody will bring their money to an economy that is not safe, to a country that is not safe. You know, we talk of FDI, foreign direct investment. Nobody will bring their dollars or their pound sterling or their euro to an to a country where, you know, they can be kidnapped or things like that, you know. So I think when government will sit up, if government should sit up to address issues of insecurity and things like that, I think we'll be on a very good track.
All right, so we'll end on that note. No country would grow if investments are not brought into it, and nobody wants to bring their investments into a country that is not safe and secure. Thank you so much, Dr. Sam Babalola, for appearing on this episode of Development Issues. That's how much we can take for this episode. Do join us again next time as we examine another issue of interest as it relates to socioeconomic growth in Africa and beyond. My name is Zainab Sani.